Welcome to our Sunday online service. I'm Jen Melkai, and we're thrilled that you've joined us today. If you are new to Trinity, text WELCOME to 262-302-3021, and Trinity will donate $5 to the charity that you choose. We'd like to share a couple things for you and your family. Light the Night, the family experience of games, hayride, bonfires, s'mores, and candy. You don't want to miss it. It is Friday, October 22nd from 5 until 7:30. We are looking for people interested in helping with this event, so you can call the office if you're interested. Well, I don't know about you, but I love a night when I don't have to cook. So, Tuesday, October 19th from 5 to 8, Culver's in Lake Geneva is the place to be. Please go out to Culver's and support our youth group. Ladies, let your light shine and join us for the Fall Women's Retreat. It's Saturday, October 23rd from 9 until 2. Head to trinitychurchfamily.com for the most up-to-date information. You are under no obligation to give, but we are humbled by your generosity and thank you for helping us serve the community. As you know, we always celebrate our 20th online giver, and this week it's dun-dun-dun-dun! Moses owns his own cafe in heaven. You know what it's called? Holy Grounds. Got one other one for you today. How do you find a huge house in heaven? Godzilla. As we prepare for worship, please make sure you have some bread, some wine, or juice so that we can participate in Holy Communion together.
As we begin our service today, you're reminded of how 2 months ago I brought this plant to every worship service for an entire month. I only allowed it to receive sun, water, minerals for 1 hour on Sunday, saying for many people that's all the spiritual nourishment they receive. But this is what happened to that plant. It was sad. It was virtually dead. No leaves at all. But after a month of rejuvenation, water, sunshine, caring for it, this plant today is actually blossoming, has come back to life. Our theme today is paradise. What happens after you die? We are grateful for our God and begin this worship service in your name, O Lord. For you are Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. You give us life. Join us as we sing.
Holy words, long preserved for our walk in this world. This world may resound.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Do not be worried and upset, Jesus told them. Believe in God and believe in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house, and I am going to prepare a place for you. I would not tell you this if it were not so. And after I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to myself, so that you will be where I am. You know the way that leads to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, so how can we know the way to get there? Jesus answered him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except by me. Now that you have known me, he said to them, you will know my Father also. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I'm not afraid.
Today we conclude our 5-week series on the five P's, the superpowers of Christianity. Today's final is this, the final P, paradise. An elderly mother planning her funeral told her pastor that she wanted to be cremated and have her ashes scattered all over Walmart. That way, I can count on my daughters visiting me twice a week. We get that, don't we? Have you ever visited a person who's near death? Were they afraid? Did you feel uncomfortable talking about faith? Here's the easiest way to begin a discussion, if the situation allows. When the time is just right, ask the person, "What do you think happens when you die?" What do you think happens when you die? After they share, you share your thoughts. Share your faith in whatever way you can. You don't have to have all the answers. There's lots of questions. But at least you'll have had a discussion. You'll have broached the subject. Don't avoid it. What do you think happens when you die? We need to recognize that not everyone believes in life after death. Warren Buffett, for example, the financial genius who once was the wealthiest man on earth, he said, "There is one thing I'm afraid of. I'm afraid to die. I adopted my father's religious morals, but not his belief in God. I have not adopted his belief in life after death. I think when you die, you go to ground." And because of that choice, Warren Buffett, one of the most successful men in the world, is stricken. He is terrified by death. Jesus said, "What do you achieve if you gain the whole world but lose your very soul?" Warren Buffett has achieved the whole world, but his eternal soul is at a point of being lost. We know that Christian faith is primarily about living and not dying. Many Christians act as if the only thing that mattered, however, is getting people into heaven. But Jesus was more interested in getting heaven into people. You see the difference? Jesus' number one sermon was this: the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Number one sermon, the kingdom of heaven is at hand, right here and right now. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth, right here as it is in heaven. Jesus said very little about the next world. He knew that if we took care of life in this world, if we were connected with God in this world, then heaven will take care of itself. To a degree, it's healthy to be afraid of death, however. It keeps us alive. But what is not healthy is to try to ignore the subject of our own death. All of us are going to die. There are no exceptions. As the old saying goes, we don't get out of this world alive. In a Benedictine monastery that I know of, once a month, all of the monks reflect on their life and their death. What have they accomplished, they ask themselves. Who have they influenced? Who have they helped? What were their joys and sorrows? And what will it be like to die? What will it be like on the other side? Thinking about death in this way produces a love for life. When we are familiar with death, we appreciate each week. We appreciate each day as a precious gift from God. The beautiful irony is that once we come to accept death, once we accept what death teaches us, we truly begin to live. Now, the Bible tells us that life after death promises to be an overwhelming experience of joy. for those of us who believe and trust in Jesus Christ. Perhaps the most familiar passage of Scripture that promises the gift of life after death is found in John 14, verses 1 through 3. Here we find Jesus in the upper room comforting his disciples before his own death. Jesus says, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you there? And when I prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also." Jesus concludes by saying, "Because I live, you will live also." As Christians, we have nothing to fear from death. With St. Paul, we know nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord, especially death. We are promised that death will be a closer walk with God, because you're still asking, however, well, what is death going to be like? All of our speculation about it is limited, because we're dealing with a journey that's beyond our comprehension. Pastor John Bailey, he told about an old country doctor who made his rounds in his horse-drawn carriage. He had his dog with him when he stopped at a house to visit a man who was dying of cancer. He entered the man's bedroom to check on him. The man asked the doctor, "How am I doing?" "It doesn't look good," said the doc. And they were both quiet for a few moments. Then the man asked, "Doctor, what's it like to die?" The doctor sat, tried to think of something to say. As the doctor was thinking, he heard his dog come up the stairs of the house, and because the bedroom door was shut, he couldn't get into the room. So the dog started whining and scratching at the door. The doctor said to the man, "You hear my dog outside the door? He has never been in this room before. He has never been in this place at all. He does not know what's on the other side of that door that he's scratching at, but he knows one thing. His master, me, he knows I am in here. Because he knows that, he knows that everything is all right." Then the doctor said, "And that's what death is like. We have never been there. We don't know what's on the other side, but one thing we do know, our Master Jesus Christ is there on the other side. And because of that, everything will be all right." The most profound explanation of dying that I've read came from Pastor Ed Beck. When Pastor Ed was serving a church in Denver, he had a 7-year-old member of the congregation named Ellen. She was dying of an incurable disease. Each time he would visit her in the hospital, she would take him by the hand, lead him to the other rooms to meet her friends, other patients in the hospital. A month before Ellen died, though, he was visiting and she said, "Pastor Beck, my mother told me to talk to you about dying. I don't want to die. Can you tell me what will happen when I die?" Ed sat in a rocking chair and put Ellen on his lap and responded, "Ellen, before you were ever born, you were in your mom's tummy, tucked away very near your mom's loving heart. At that time, let's suppose someone had said to you, 'Ellen, you can no longer live in your mom's tummy. It's time for you to die out of your mom's tummy.' Now, Ellen, let's suppose you said, I don't want to leave my mom's tummy. I love it here. It's nice. It's comfortable. I feel very much loved in my mom's tummy. I don't want to die out of my mom's tummy. I don't want to be born because that means I'd have to leave this wonderful place. Pastor Ed continued and said, but Ellen, you already know what happened. You did die out of your mom's tummy. And look what you discovered. You discovered in this world there are loving arms to hold you, loving faces smiling at you, and everyone wanting to meet your every need. And now for 7 years, you've discovered how wonderful it is to be a part out of your mom's tummy. In fact, it's so wonderful you don't even want to die. You don't want to leave here because you know you're loved by your mom, your dad, your grandma's brother, sister, so many, many others, including me. Ellen, there soon will come a time when you will die. And here is what's going to happen. The moment you die, you will discover strong, loving arms holding you, loving faces smiling at you, and everyone will want to meet your every need. You'll be surrounded by such love, such beauty, that soon you will say, I love it here. I don't ever want to leave. And Ellen, you won't. You will remain there and live with Jesus and your loved ones in Christ forever. Ellen, that's what's going to happen when you die. Then Pastor Ed concluded, oh, and one last thing, when you welcome me into heaven, because you'll be there, I will meet you. Will you take me by my hand and lead me from door to door, just like you did today? So I can meet all of your friends? Yes, said Ellen, I promise. Wow. The testimony of Scripture is that we should love life. Love life. Life is God's creation, God's gracious gift to us. This is why many Christians have difficulty with such current topics as abortion, assisted suicide, capital punishment, because life is precious. Life is a gift. We understand the issues involved when a young woman has an unwanted pregnancy. We have compassion when an older person is suffering with a terminal painful illness. And we know justice requires that lawbreakers be punished. But life is a gift from God. And even though we are Christians, on both sides of every great issue, our natural inclination is to tread carefully any time human life is to be taken. Jesus said in John 10, verse 10, I have come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Jesus talked about heaven and hell. Some are living a hellish experience right now, and it will continue on into eternity if they choose to live life without God. A godless eternity is truly hellish, and it's one person's choice. It's your choice. If you want to live life without God starting today, hell is at hand even now. But God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life, beginning right now. When you accept the Lord, heaven, a taste of heaven, begins immediately. So if you have friends who don't believe in God, remember that one of the greatest gifts we have, one of our superpowers, is the promise of paradise. And your friend, your family member, your fellow student may very well come to faith through your sharing. I conclude with Dr. Diane Comp. She's a pediatric oncologist working with cancer. She said, "When I first entered the medical field, I was an atheist. I didn't believe in God. I didn't believe in heaven, any of that. But working with dying children created an unshakable faith in God for me." Anna was typical from my early medical practice. Her case was similar to so many others. 7-year-old Anna had fought leukemia for 5 years. She had no more strength to fight, unfortunately. But moments before she died, the little girl suddenly sat up in bed and announced that she saw angels. A smile lit up her face, and she described their beautiful singing. Ah! And then this little girl, radiant with joy, laid her head down and died. It was just like I described. This kind of experience has happened so often, said Dr. Comp, that I knew there was a God, and I knew there was a beautiful world beyond. We Christians, we profess that because Jesus, who died for the forgiveness of our sins, rose from the dead, he overcame death and the grave, and he said, "Because I live, you will live also." Eternal life, paradise, a taste of it begins the moment you believe. So won't you join me in renewing your faith right now? Won't you join me in this prayer and accepting Christ as your Lord and Savior? Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we have all sinned and fallen short of your glory. Please forgive us. You designed us from the beginning. You have a plan for our life. And Lord, if we were the only person on earth, you would have died for us. That's how much you love us. Lord, we accept you into your heart. I accept you into my life. Lord Jesus, help me to begin living for you right now, and may it continue on into heaven. Lord, you are my Lord and Savior. Receive me as your child. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Child of God, as you walk with the Lord, when you leave this world, you will walk directly into paradise through your faith in Jesus. Amen.
I can only imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in all of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
On the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body. This is given for you." In the same manner, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he blessed it, and he gave it to them, saying, "Take and drink. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you, for the forgiveness of your sins. As many times as you eat of this bread and drink from this cup, remember my sacrifice on the cross for you." And now we remember our Lord and Savior by saying the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, if you would take your communion kit and peel off the top, take out the wafer, and listen to Jesus' words. "Take and eat. This is my body given for you." And now if you would take the cup and remember his words on that very final night when he said, "Take and drink. This is my blood shed for you." And now may the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Praise.
of ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
As we conclude our service today, I want you to remember that we, as Christians, have the five P's, our superpowers. What we have to offer non-believers, what we have to encourage one another. We talked about purpose for our lives. God gives us purpose. God provides pardon from our sins. He gives us power through prayer, peace that passes all understanding, and when we leave this planet, paradise. All of these are the great gifts that we have as followers of Jesus. They are available to you, and we encourage you to tell other people about them. You can go back on our website, listen to old sermons, these five sermons, just so you remember, and step out. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with His favor and give you purpose, pardon, power, peace, and paradise. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Amen.
Over all the earth, you reign on high. Every mountain stream, every sunset sky. But my one request, but my only aim, is that you reign in me again. Lord, reign in me, reign in your power. Over all my dreams, in my darkest hour, you are the Lord. The beauty of my Lord, you mean more to me than any earthly thing. So won't you reign in me again? Lord, reign in me, reign in your power. Over all my dreams, in my darkest hour, you are the Lord of all I am. So won't you reign in me again? Lord, reign in me, reign in your power. So won't you reign in me again? So won't you reign in me again?
As we go in peace, don't forget, November 7th. November 7th. All of our worship services will be in the building from that day on. 9 o'clock, 10:30. Why don't you invite some of your neighbors? It would be so great. They're lonely. They will experience hope. Don't forget, what is our mission? To help my neighbor make a positive, life-changing connection with Jesus Christ. Let's go do it. God bless you. Thank you.
God has a plan. Trust it, live it, enjoy it, and may God bless your day.